water on the table. Water.
Hey, welcome back, everybody.
I'm
really happy about introducing our next speaker because Dolores is one of our very, very favorite people in the entire world. And not just because of who she is, which is a beautiful soul, but, you know, she really knows stuff. You know, can you imagine... you know, you're not exactly in the beginning of your life. You're in the middle of your life, and you find out about this crazy thing called hypnosis, right? Well, it's been around for ages, but, you know, you start dabbling in it, and you start regressing people to try to help them with, you know, various issues, stopping to smoke or, you know, whatever. And you're regressing these people, and all of a sudden, you find that you're not talking directly to their consciousness anymore. You're convening with somebody else, okay? And this somebody else has a personality and has a way of speaking and is imparting a body of knowledge that this person you've hypnotized cannot possibly know anything about. And then you're hypnotizing a person maybe across the other part of the state, you know, 300 or 400 miles away, and you're hypnotizing a whole different person. And you have them under, and you're trying to get them to stop smoking, and all of a sudden, this same entity, this same intelligence that spoke through another subject hundreds of miles away, starts talking to you again. Hey, I'm back. You start paying attention. She's been doing this now for almost 20 years. And the information has been coming through to her. Her books are legion. They're incredible, the information, the knowledge. Now, Dolores has really kind of gotten her mind around the body of UFO-related information that she's been receiving over all of these years. And she thinks she's going to be able to really connect a lot of dots for all of us and really try to bring the UFO picture into a clear focus. So we're really, really looking forward to this one. Ladies and gentlemen, Dolores Cannon.
Okay. Okay, Doggy, that's not too bad. Usually they have the lights so bright that I can't see anybody. Then you're talking to a wall. I don't like that. The mic is echoing. Is that okay?
No.
Can you hear me all right? Because it sounds to me like it's reverberating. Can you turn it down a little bit so we won't have the echoing? Okay, maybe that's better for me anyway. Otherwise, you have the sound bouncing off the walls. Okay, I just came in last night from Hawaii. Oh, darn. So I'm still on, you know, adjusting the time. But we left Arkansas, where I live, a week ago in 20 degrees and snow. So I was really glad to get out of there and get to Hawaii. And I knew we had to hook it onto this trip and just keep going. But I'm traveling now all over the world, all the time. And when I am home, it's mostly just the holidays. So I just got over my little time at home, and now I'm on the road again. Last year, we did a complete round-the-world trip. First time to do that. First time in South Africa, and we just kept going one country after the other. We were gone for 2 or 3 weeks. And then I came home for 2 weeks and had to go back to England and to Russia. Only home another week and off again to Australia, New Zealand. So that's the way it's been, just one trip after the other all over the world. And because the information is spreading and my work has taken on a different turn to it, I'm mostly teaching now my technique everywhere I go. And especially in Russia, I was in Russia 4 times this last year. The doctors in Russia really want to learn what I've found. So this is important for you to understand what I do. A lot of these people, I think, do know my books, because I've been into hypnosis for 40 years, 30 years doing the past life regression. But then I found that was only the tip of the iceberg, and it took a totally different turn after that. And now I'm doing a therapy you won't even believe, in addition to finding all the knowledge that I've accumulated. But the main thing I'm teaching now is we have found how to have instantaneous healing. And that's what I'm teaching. This is something that happened in my work, the tip of the iceberg with the past life regressions. Then I found a way to contact the source of all knowledge. And that's what I'll be talking about, because that's where my information comes from. The source of all knowledge, why not work with something that big? And that's the one that has been doing the healing as I work with the clients. I don't do anything. I'm just a facilitator to allow it to happen and come through the clients I work with. But I've also been working in the UFO field for 25 years, and I've written 4 books on that. But you have to understand, I don't channel, I'm not a psychic, I'm a hypnotherapist. I call myself the reporter, the investigator, the researcher of lost knowledge, because that's the way it began to be, to turn into finding things that nobody knew. To me, that is so exciting to be able to do that. So we got into the UFO field also. It's just like, there wasn't anything that I wasn't getting involved with. But I was doing the past life regressions is when I discovered this power that I'm going to talk about. Those of you who have read my books, I call it the subconscious. But it is not the subconscious the way it is defined by the psychiatrist. That's a childish part of the mind. That's the part that hypnotists use when they want to stop smoking, lose weight, do the habits. That's not the part of the mind that I work with. I didn't know what to call it, because it began coming through all the people I was working with. Then I found a way to call it in, and that's why I'm teaching that. I call it the subconscious. You may want to call it the oversoul, the higher self, the higher consciousness. But it is so big and so huge, it has the answers to everything. And it has tremendous power. And this is what I've contacted during the session when we're doing the therapy. And I've done thousands and thousands of people. And so if I'm getting the same information and the same contact through all of these people, you know that I had to discover something. To me, it is very valuable. Because especially when it comes to the healing. And I'm teaching my courses now. One place is the college in Santa Fe. They're giving 1.5 college credits now for my class that I give there. And I'm doing it all over the world. The doctors everywhere are interested in it, because we have found a way, well, to bypass the medical profession anyway, which is what I like. But I have spent hours just talking about the cases and the things we have done there. But we're not going to do that today. Today we're going to focus on new information that I've gotten. To me, is the missing pieces of the UFO puzzle. Now, over all these years, I have been getting bits and pieces of information that I put in my books. I've written 15 books about all the adventures I've had doing hypnosis and using these methods. So a lot of it dealt with the history that I discovered and wrote about that. But then I began to get into something much different, especially when I contacted, I call it the subconscious. They say, we don't care what you call us, we'll work with you. But when I found out, when I got into that, information was coming through the clients I was working with. I don't interrupt the session. I'm there for the therapy and the counseling with the person. But when something is needed, a new theory that I have to know about or new information, they just interrupt the session and tell me, Dolores, this is what you need to know for your next book. Now, so it did give me more and more information. I've learned to trust them totally. They're so full of love. I call them they. I don't know what else to call them. They say they are a group, but it is so high that it has all knowledge. So when I began working with the UFO field, I thought I was getting everything there. But now I'm even getting more. And as I look back on my books, I can see bits and pieces that I wrote about over the years. And then it was isolated. Well, now in the last couple of years, it's begun to fall together and finally make sense. I can see a pattern that I finally see the reason for it all happening. And it's not going to be what you think it is. I'm just going to try not to go too much over your heads. I don't know how you are in metaphysics. I don't know how much information you can take before I completely blow your minds, I guess you would say. They started out with me with just the little baby steps and little spoon feeding. And I said, if they hadn't have done that, I would never have understood it. I would have thrown it all away and say, no, I don't understand. It doesn't make sense. They have to spoon feed you a little piece of information at a time, let you digest that, then you get a little more, and it gets a little more complicated as you go along. But now it's really getting into some very deep stuff. That's why I'm writing the Convoluted Universe series. And each one of those books has gotten more and more complicated. And every time I think I have everything you could possibly want to know, they'll say, oh no, there's more. So the information I'm going to give today is for Convoluted Universe Book 4. The book is not out yet. I'm still putting it together. But the information pours out of the people I work with. And that's all I have to do is put it together, which is no small task. It's like putting a puzzle together. You get a piece from one client, a piece from another, and then I put it together and it begins to form a picture. So that's what it's beginning to do now. One of the reasons I'm getting information the other investigators are not, especially the UFO investigators, is because I work in the deepest possible level of trance, which is called the somnambulistic level, the deepest level you can work at. The other UFO investigators have told me they won't touch it. They won't go there. Even Bud Hopkins told me, oh, no, no, I'm not going to work in that level, he said, because he's afraid of what he would find there. But what you do is you find the truth. Because in the lighter levels of trance, the person's personality is very present. Any of you who have had hypnosis and past life regressions at the lighter levels, you say, oh, I made the whole thing up. You know, it was silly. Why did I bring that up? I read it in a book or I saw it in a movie. The conscious mind is very present. We don't want the conscious mind. The conscious mind is the stupidest part of the human being. It doesn't know anything. Thinks it does. And it tries to judge everything. We don't want that part. So what I do is get the conscious mind totally out of the picture so it can't interrupt, it can't interfere with what we're finding. Otherwise, it'll be interrupting, saying, oh, this is silly, I'm making it up, et cetera, et cetera. Now, the other investigators have told me they work at the lighter levels of trance. So when the person is having a UFO experience, they're caught in the emotion, the fear, and they can't get past that. You don't want that. That's the human mind. The human mind is distorting the experience. So in all of my work, I work at the deepest possible level, removing the conscious mind out of the picture. The person has no memory at all of what has happened during the entire session. They wake up and they'll say, oh, I'm sorry, I fell asleep on you. They don't remember what we have covered. You see how much more valuable it can be if you get the conscious mind interference out of the way. Now, I'm going to say they, you'll know who I'm speaking about, the ones that are helping with this. They say the ideal situation, especially with UFO experiences, is that the person never remember anything. They don't want to interfere with a person's life. They've been coming since the beginning of the world. So they've nothing new, but they don't want to interfere with a person's life. So they said it would be better off if the person never remember anything so they could continue on with their life. But they said they have no control over the chemistry of the brain. Our chemistry of our brain is now being influenced by the pollutants in the air, the additives in the food. If the person is on alcohol, drugs of any kind, recreational drugs or medical drugs, anything like that is distorting the chemistry of the person's brain. So if they have an experience, they are remembering it in a distorted fashion, not the way it really occurred. Can that make sense to you? It's going through that fear filter, because if somebody doesn't understand something, they're afraid of it. Fear is the strongest emotion a human has. So that is, you're going to bring in that fear and it will distort the real thing that happened. I've done this for so many years in so many cases. I work with investigators all over the world. Someone probably will have a case that they will work with, tell me about all the horrible things that were done to that person. I will have the same client and we will get to the truth. It's a totally different story because it's not being distorted with the conscious mind. Afterwards, a person will say, if that's what happened, I can handle it, because they find out it was not at all what they thought it was. But to me, that's therapy, when you can help the person to find out the truth and move on from there. So over the years, I've been getting these stories, and they're totally different than the other investigators are getting. Because to me, the ETs are a wonderful, positive group, because I found out why they're coming, I know what they're doing, and it is all for the benefit of mankind. Why bring in this fear part when it's not necessary at all? So I want you to understand that, because we're going to have to go back and explain this so you can understand the information I'm getting now. Okay, first of all, well, nobody has ever had a UFO experience unless they've agreed to it anyway. I know they don't believe that, but that is the truth. Now, I have, like I said, I've worked with thousands and thousands of people. We have gone through every kind of past life you could possibly imagine. Every one of you have had past lives. I've not found a single person who has not. It doesn't mean just Earth. Earth is one school that you're going to, but it's not the only school. You've been around forever, and you're going to continue to be around forever. Earth is a very young planet, isolated over here in this part of the galaxy for a reason. They don't want us contaminating the rest of the universe. They're really afraid of us with our violence, so they're keeping us isolated. But you've been around ever since you were created, having all kinds of adventures before coming to Earth. You've lived on other planets, other dimensions, things you can't even possibly imagine. I have had people going to all of these different places, and you've all done that before deciding to come to Earth. This is just a school, but it's a school where you can't skip a grade, but you can have to repeat a grade if you don't get it right. And you don't get out of Earth school until you can graduate. This means you have to experience absolutely everything. So that's why I want you to understand, I hope that everybody understands reincarnation anyway. I don't want to start at the beginning of that anyway. But you have a body. You are not a body. This is just a suit of clothes, a costume you're wearing right now to play this part in this play. It's all it is a play, a game. It's an illusion. This is what you're wearing right now to play this part. But you've had many other costumes you've worn, other planets, other dimensions. Some of them you wouldn't even think were alive. But you have done it all. Now you've come to Earth. Earth is the most challenging planet in the universe. They don't want to come here. It's very, very difficult to live on Earth. In the Earth School, you learn emotions and limitations. And there are many places in the universe, other planets, where they don't have those kind of lessons. But it's a difficult planet to live on because of that. They said they admire you when you say you want to come to Earth, because it takes a lot of bravery to come here. This is the lowest, densest planet there is. The energy is very, very low, very, very dense. So can you imagine they don't want to come here to live? But you learn a great deal by being here, but you all chose to come. Now, when I take people into the past lives, whenever you leave the life, you go to the spirit side. And I've written books on this. What is it like to die? Where you go on the other side? All the places you go to. You always go through what is called a life review. You look over the life you have just left, and you see all the things you've done, all the things you've said, every experience you've ever had. But you also see them through the eyes of everybody you've been involved with. And when you start looking at it, it's like, oh my gosh, I didn't know I hurt them that bad. I didn't know what I said affected them in that way. You're seeing it from a totally different direction. And there is no God sitting up there on a throne who is going to punish you and judge you. You look at your life and you judge yourself. There's no harsher judge than you yourself. And you're the one who makes the arrangements with the other souls you have harmed and created karma with. Let's go back and do it again. Because you never get out of it until you've worked it out. These are important points because I'm going to bring them up as we go along. I hope you understand karma anyway. But you have created this with other people. And you have a discussion with these souls before you're going to come back. You'll say, we didn't do a very good job of it, did we? Let's go back and do it again. This time you be the husband, I'll be the wife. Or you be the mother, I'll be the child. You can reverse roles around any way you want because it is just a play. We're just here experiencing this right now. So when you are making these plans, you make your plan when you're going to come back on what you will do, or at least hope to accomplish. It doesn't matter if you don't accomplish everything, at least if you try. You make a plan on what you want to try to accomplish. Now, when you are making those plans, the ETs are also very much involved because they're all experiencing lives going back and forth also. And they will talk to you and say, you know, while you're on Earth this time, we're going to be involved in this project. Would you like to be part of it? And you say, okay, it sounds interesting. I'll volunteer to be part of this project. Now, over there, everything looks simple, looks easy. They'll say, oh, I can do all of that. But then when you come here, it's not that easy because you get caught up in the emotions. Everybody comes in with their own little plan, and everything clashes. There's all the emotions you have to live with. And you don't realize that when you say, I'm going to do this and come back. But another trick to the whole thing is, when you come in, you have your plan, you know what you want to accomplish. All the parts are very clear over there, but when you get here, you don't remember anymore. Because as soon as you come into the body, all memory is erased. See, you come in with the blinders on. I have people that I've taken through the birth experience. And they're saying, I gotta remember. And then they're being born and they'll say, I don't remember anymore. I asked them one time, wouldn't it be easier if we remembered our plan, if we remembered what we were going to try to accomplish? if we remembered our association with other people, wouldn't that be easier? They said, no, it wouldn't be a test if you knew the answers. So you have to come in and fumble around till you get back to remembering again. That's what's happening right now. Things are changing in the world. We call it the veil is thinning. It's called the awakening. The veil is beginning to lift. We're finally beginning to figure out why we're here and what we're supposed to be doing, because this is a very important time in the world to be here right now. But you all volunteered to be here right now, and that's the important thing. Okay. Now, in order to understand what I'm going to be telling you, you have to go back to the beginning of the world. That's all the way back to explain it. Because when you come to Earth, you live lives after life after life. You have hundreds and hundreds of lives because you have to understand every single situation. You have to be every nationality. You have to be every religion. You have to live on every continent in the world. You see the amount of knowledge you must accumulate? You can't do all of that in one lifetime. This can take hundreds and hundreds of lifetimes to learn all of these things before you can go back and graduate. So you accumulate karma during that time. What goes around comes around. That's a law of the universe. It must be paid back. So if you've been doing this for hundreds and hundreds of lives, a lot of us get stuck. We're just making the same mistake again and again and again instead of moving forward. They said, doesn't matter to them how long it takes you to learn a lesson. You have eternity. Do you want to take eternity to learn it? Because every time you come back with karma, you are put together with the same people, same circumstances, only now it's even a little harder until you finally learn the lesson. That's what I mean by the awakening. The veils start lifting. We have gotten trapped in karma. We're going round and around in the wheel of karma instead of progressing. This is very important to the story that I'm going to be telling you. Okay. But in the very, very beginning, and I've lectured on this other times at this conference, we were created by the ETs. So they have been involved with us since the very, very beginning. This is why they have so much interest in us, because they have always taken care of us since the very beginning. In the very beginning, whenever there are councils, there's councils over solar systems, there's councils over galaxies, there's councils over universes. They're all very set plans and rules and regulations that everything is run by. So whenever a planet reaches the point when it can support life, this is very, very important in the history of that planet. And it goes into the council in the history books. The planet is now ready to receive life. It has to be cooled down to the point where life can exist. Now, I have taken people back, and see, I don't lead these people. They just go to these past lives. Some of these people have gone back to when the world was being created. I've had them be part of when the universes were being created. You've all done that. You've all been co-creators. You imagine the power you have, and you don't even realize it. You were here. You were able to do those things. It means you can do them again once you understand that. I've had them go back to where the oceans were being created, and they were part of all of that. And I've also had them there when the volcanoes were erupting and life couldn't form on Earth yet because the atmosphere was too full of ammonia. So they had to wait till it cooled down enough that life could form. They said this was all done by what they call the archaic ones, the ancient ones. And this means they've been around forever. They said in the very beginning, the archaic ones did it because that was how they were formed. And as they went out into space and began to travel, Their job was to create life on any planet that was suitable to have life. And people always say, well, how does God fit into this picture? This is a way of putting the evolutionist theory and the creationist theory together, because God is very much involved in the picture. They call him the source of everything, and that's where we all began. Every one of us started with the source, including the ETs. They are closer to God, if you want to call him that, than we will ever be, because they've been following his instructions since the beginning, but also they depend on him for their very life. They don't consume food the way we do. They absorb light through their bodies. And we're eventually getting to that point. We're all progressing in that direction. They absorb light through the skin. And I said, well, where does the light come from? It comes from the source. So they are closer to him than we will ever be. And they have been receiving instructions since the beginning of time. You go here, you go there, this is what they do. Many of them never go back to their home planets. Many of them don't even have a home planet to go back to because it's been destroyed. So this is their job, to just go from place to place, checking on these things. Can you imagine how many eons of time this would take as you had to go and keep progressing and checking all of this? Because it would be thousands and thousands of years on each part of all of this. So when the Earth finally cooled down enough to support life, they said, go to Earth and introduce life on a cellular stage. And they never know what the life is going to look like. The important thing is to get life started. Start it with a single cell organism, and then it will multiply. To get life of some kind going, they don't care what it forms into as long as it is life and begins to grow. First it'll be plants, then animals. It takes a long time. I'm probably going to have to condense this down some because there's a great deal of information to cover. But they go back from time to time to check on it and see, is this growing? Are they turning into multi-celled organisms? I've had people go back to past lives when they were the seeders, the ones who were doing the planting of these cells. And other ones go back to where they were the recorders, who would check and see how are things going? How are the plants developing? How is everything moving along? I think if you look at these this way, you'll see the ETs are not at all what you think they are. They've been very involved with us since the very beginning. But as you gradually progressed, they said you have no idea how fragile life is, because they would go back sometimes and they would find something, a multi-celled organism had begun, and then they would check on it again and it had fallen apart and the planet was lifeless again. Then there was a lot of great sadness about it, because they said life is so fragile, it has to be cared for, it has to be nurtured to get it to grow. So this is why they've been so involved with us, because they really care about us and it is their job. But as life went along and things did begin to, I'm going to condense here, they began to have life and it went into the animal stages. Each stage was taken care of by them and developed by them. Most of the animals were brought from other planets to see what would grow here, what would adjust here. So it's been a very long events of all of the whole things leading up to humans. Then it came to time to introduce humans. A lot of this is in my books, so you can find out about it. But as humans were introduced, they looked at this planet and they said, let's give this beautiful planet a creature with free will and see what he does with it. Believe me, they're not happy. What is he going to do with it if we give him free will? Well, we're not supposed to do what we are doing now. But the law of non-interference is another one of the rules. Give it free will, and then stand back and see what they're going to do with it. And then they are not allowed to interfere with the development of a civilization. It's the Star Trek rule, but believe me, it's not fiction, it's very real. You have to let the people do what they're going to do, and you can't interfere. So, as time went on, man began to develop from the animals, and it was a half animal, half human for a long time. Then you're going to have to introduce civilization. No, in all through history, you never heard of any caveman suddenly coming out of his cave and saying, I'm going to plant something and see if it's going to grow. I'm going to learn how to harvest. It's not done that way. Every culture in the world has the legends of the culture bringer. You know, the Indians have their corn woman. There's always the culture bringer who brings some kind of civilization and knowledge. They come and they teach them how to plant. They bring fire. In all of these legends, they always come and show the developing species how to learn how to grow. And in all of these legends, the culture bringer always came from the sky or from across the water. In all of the legends. Now, as this began to happen, they would give them the next thing they needed. And I asked them, well, isn't that interference if you're giving them something? They said, no, we give them the next gift at the next time they're supposed to have it in their time in history. What they do with it is up to them. And they said, most of the time, they don't use it the way we want them to use it. They aren't doing it the way we wanted them to do it. Most of the time, they turn things into weapons, as you well know, which they weren't intended to be. So they said, I said, well, can't you just go back and say, you're not doing it right? They said, that is interference. We give it to them a gift one time. What they do with it is up to them. If we go and do anything else, it's interference. So they've been sitting there shaking their heads all of these years as they watch us develop, wanting us to go in the right direction. So all of this went along for many years, and a lot of times these culture bringers would live among the people. And because they live as long as they want to, ETs don't die until they're ready to die. They have complete control over their body. They live as long as they want to. Because they live as long as they want to, they were brought the legends of the gods in all of these countries of the world. You've all heard the legends of the different gods. That were the ETs living with them to teach them and progress the civilization. Well, as we began to get too many people in the world, they can no longer come and live among us and tell us what they're supposed to do. So now, when it's time for a new invention, a new advancement to be brought into our world, it's put into the atmosphere. Whoever picks it up and invents it is the one who gets the credit for it. You know, many people all over the world are always working on the same inventions at the same time, when the time is right. They don't care who invents it as long as it's in the timeline that it is supposed to be. So they're still helping us in that way, giving us the next step along the way. Okay. So this is the way it's being done now, and they've been still monitoring us and watching us the whole time, shaking their heads and saying, when are these kids going to get it right? They're really afraid of us because of our violence. They said we'll never be able to join with them and work with these communities, the galactic communities, until we get rid of our violence. But it all goes back to the fact that we came from the animals, and we still have that animal nature. But we're the violent ones, and they're afraid of us. That's why they don't want to have any more involvement with us than they have to. Okay. So, I got so much information flooding into my head. Okay, let's take it in order, guys, get it together. Okay. So as they've been watching us and monitoring us all this time, they didn't like all the wars we were being involved with and all the things we were doing. Well, something happened in the end of the 1940s that really got their attention. This was when we developed the atomic bomb, right at the end of World War II. And they'd been watching us, but then when they saw that happen, they said, we better get down there and see what these kids are up to. They're playing around with something they're not supposed to be. We were not supposed to have that information yet. We were not supposed to have that knowledge, that invention. It was got in here before its time. Whenever we were supposed to get the knowledge of atomic power, it was supposed to have been used for good. They knew we couldn't handle it. So what do? We develop it as a weapon. It's exactly what they didn't want us to do. Now, the only time they can interfere in the development of Earth would be if we reached the point where we were going to destroy the world. If it got to that point, they would have to step in, because if we destroyed this little planet, you think, what is the importance of this little planet over here? If we were to destroy our world, it would send reverberations throughout the solar system, throughout the galaxies. It would disturb other dimensions. There are other civilizations in other dimensions that we can't see. It would disturb everything and cause chaos. So they said it would not be allowed if we were to get to the point of destroying our world. That's the only time they would have to step in and interfere. So that's the first thing they thought of. Look what they've done. They have developed atomic power when they weren't even supposed to have it yet. They knew the danger of the possibility it could be. So they said, we better get down here and find out what's going on. Now, if you remember, at the late 40s, at the end of the war, was when the UFO flap began. There were isolated incidents before that. During the war, they were the ones they called the Foo Fighters, who were in the war. Those were just observers. But they didn't really get involved until at that time, at the end of the war, and that's when you began seeing the influx of UFO sightings began at that time. This is why. They came down here to figure out what's going on. Well, they knew, look, even after the war, we were all in the Cold War, it was a very dangerous situation. So it was like, okay, what are we going to do? You couldn't stop it. You couldn't take it away. That's interference. They couldn't just come in and tell you to stop all of this. So what they decided to do, I think, is brilliant. They came up with a very fascinating answer. They said they went back to the councils and they said, we're going to have to do something. See, the problem with Earth, we are all caught on that wheel of karma, going round and round and around, making the same mistakes again and again and again. You can't handle something that powerful. We would destroy the world. So they went back and said, what are we going to do? We can't just step in and stop, because that is interference. Well, the brilliant solution they came up with, they said, okay, we can't influence from the outside, but we can influence from the inside. This is the plan they came up to what they decided to do. Earth was caught on the wheel, too entrenched in karma. What if we bring in souls that have never been on Earth before, pure souls, souls that are not contaminated, souls that have never been caught up in the wheel of karma? What if we bring them in and let them work from the inside? They said that way it's not interference, especially if you ask for volunteers. You're not making anything happening. Are you following me? I know it's getting a little involved. That's why I wanted to try to do it step by step. You bring in souls that have never been trapped on the wheel of karma, who have never had it, never been here before. Maybe they could make a difference by influencing people in another way. So what they did, the call went out to the universes. Earth is in trouble. We need volunteers. We need people to come and help Earth. So the call went out all over. This sounds strange, but whenever I get hundreds of people telling me the same story when they're in this deep trance and they have no idea what I have received, it's got to be coming from somewhere. I always say the more information I get, the same story that adds validity to it. So now when I'm doing the sessions, used to be they would go back to past lives. And that was where we did the therapy. Now I'm finding the only ones that I get past lives from are those who are still involved in karma and working out their karma. Now I'm having it happen time and time again. Instead of going back into past lives, they go back to the source when they were created by God and they've never left God. Or they are going back to lives when they were ETs, if you want to call them that, on spaceships, on other planets and other dimensions. That's what I'm getting now. And the people are just like you. They have no idea about this other part of themselves. They're just like you, and the memories are all there in their mind. And it comes through when I use this method of deep hypnosis. The same story comes out again and again. Now, when I did the Coast to Coast a few months ago, we were on the air all night long, and I was telling these stories. Afterwards, we had over 3,000 emails in just 2 days. People really identified with what I was saying. But one of them said, George Nuri wouldn't let you finish. He said, I would get to something, and I think he was a little afraid of what it was going to lead to, and he wouldn't let me complete the story. One of them was, people said, he wouldn't let you talk about the source. He wouldn't let you talk about God. And maybe they are a little afraid of what we're going to find, but believe me, it's beautiful. So you want me, I can tell you about God, okay? Because I'm not going to say anything about the church, but really they are caught in their own thing. They have not really explored what it is all about. But what I have found, I've had many, many people now who go back to the beginning when they were with God. We were all there in the beginning. That's where we all started out. The source. And whenever we left the source, it exploded out. It said, go, my children, and learn. Learn everything and bring the information back. That's why there is no good, there is no bad. It's only experiences, lessons. What do you learn from those lessons? Well, they've all described God or the source the same way. First thing you're going to have to get over thinking he is a man. If anything, he would be a woman. Because the woman is the creative force, if he was going to be one or the other. But he is neither. It's an energy. We tend to personify because that's the way our brains work. It is a tremendous energy. And when they describe it as a huge, bright light. Some of them talk about the great central sun. And some of them say, I am in the sun, but it is not like the sun we know. It's a tremendous, huge, bright light. And when they go there, all they feel is total love. They are together. Everyone is together. And you don't know how that feels. They say, I'm back, I'm home. They always say, I'm home. And the feeling is so tremendous, they don't want to leave because they're all together. And when they were sent out, they felt a separateness. And a lot of us are still looking for that. We want to go back. We always want to go home. We don't understand where home is, but we know it's not here. But when they go back to that, it is such a tremendous feeling. They have love washing over them. I've seen the body shake and convulse because they're experiencing the beauty of it. So when they go to that part, I'll say, well, you know, I know I'm talking to a body laying on the bed. And I say, well, it was so beautiful and they don't want to leave, then why did you leave? They had to if I'm speaking to them now. And they will always say the same thing. I heard the call and I volunteered to go. And a lot of times they're on the spirit side, I've had them being meetings, and these spirits will be talking to them saying, Earth is in trouble, will you want to go and help? And they've never been anywhere. Imagine what that would be like, that pure, that uncontaminated, and to come here? When they come into the body, it's like, oh my, what was I thinking about? As Earth is, it's the densest, heaviest planet there is. And when they come into the body, when they're being born, they'll say, I don't want to be here. It's just so heavy and dense. I like it better when I was over there. So this is what God is. It is a tremendous energy. And it's so full of total love. But some of these people have come, and you're going to find out by the time I get finished with this, many of you are sitting here right now. But this is what happened when I did it on the air. Everybody was identifying with, I'm going to tell you the signs of how to know if you're one or not. But other ones were on spaceships, UFOs, other planets. They also heard the call. Because they go back to this life when they're just living a normal life as an alien body. And then I said, well, what happened? Why did you come? I heard the call. He said, the call went out. Anybody who wants to help Earth, come. Earth is in trouble. And they all decided to come. But when you come, the memories are taken away. So here they are, stuck in the body. So what I've found is three waves, I call them, the three waves of volunteers. The ones, now many of you are probably the old school, still stuck on the wheel of karma, but I think when you're interested in these kind of things, maybe your mind is opening up, maybe you are part of the other groups. Because everything is changing now. The first wave, when I wrote my book, Keepers of the Garden, he was the first one I found, and I didn't know what in the world it was. Now I'm finding it again and again and again, and I call them the first timers. The first wave, I think, are like in their 50s now. So you can see, I said the age when it all started. My daughter says she thinks I'm being too rigid on these ages because some of them may overlap. But the first wave had the most difficult time of all. They are like in their 40s and 50s. But I've had some contact me that are in their early 60s, and they think, I think I fall into the same category. So you can't be too rigid, but it started right after the atomic bomb when the first call went out. The first wave, most of them, their whole life, they've not wanted to be here. They felt like they didn't belong. They said, I don't want to be here. They don't understand the violence. I want to go back. I don't want to be here. I want to go home. I don't know where home is, but it's not here. Many of that first wave have tried to commit suicide because they don't want to be here. They've had a very difficult time. Now the second wave, I think, are going in their 40s and the 30s. The second wave is like channels of energy. They say they are antennas. They are just here as a generator to let energy flow through them, and so that they can send it out to other people. All they have to do is walk through a mall, walk through a crowded store, and their energy affects everybody. Of course, they don't know it's doing that, but that's what they're here for, is to spread the energy. You don't have to do anything. They said they just have to be. So they have a lot more peaceful than the first one did. And I asked them one time, why did the second group have a much easier time than the first group did? They said because the first group were the way showers, the pioneers. Somebody had to blaze the trail. The second group followed after that. And we're probably going to get into some more. Oh, the second group, too, usually don't have children, because they said having children creates karma. They just want to do their job and get out of here. They don't want to get stuck. Just do this assignment, then we're all going back home where we're supposed to go. Now, the third wave are the new children. These are the ones that are the hope of the world. They are coming in with everything in place. Everybody's DNA is being changed because we are moving into a whole new world, a whole new earth. The DNA is being changed in our bodies so we can adapt to the frequencies, the changes of the frequencies. The new children the DNA is already there. It's already adapted. They are in place. We have to play catch up. Let me say something before I forget it. Okay, when this energy came into the bodies at the first time, you imagine how that energy would be so, well, alien is a good word, even if it came from the source, it would be so different to enter into a human body that the energy is so strong and it doesn't match the energy of the human body. So many times when they first tried the experiment of getting their soul into the fetus, the energy was too strong. This meant the mother's energy also was not compatible. So many times it would cause the baby to abort or to have miscarriage because the energies wouldn't match. So when that happened, they would try again if it was supposed to be those parents. And this time they said, well, we'll just send part of the energy in, of the soul, so that the fetus can handle it. And then as the child grows older, we'll give a little more of the energy. So if you can understand this, it's as though the whole soul does not enter at one time. So many people have noticed changes in their life from childhood as it goes along. They said something different was happening, because some of the energy was being downloaded little by little until the body could handle it. And I've had clients that tell me after we have that, they say, you know, my mother did have several miscarriages before I was born. That was why they had to adjust with the mother's energy as well as the new incoming soul's energy, because it was too different. So this is important as I go along with this. But these are the three waves, and it has caused problems because they don't understand why they're here. I think one thing is ironic about the second wave. They're supposed to be interacting with people because their energy influences everybody around them. But a lot of them don't want to be here. They don't like people. They don't like the way it makes them feel, so they isolate themselves away from people. And I said, that's defeating the purpose. How ironic. You're here to help with the people, and yet you close yourself away from them. But my daughter thinks maybe that means those are still influencing by just being here. their energy maybe is helping in that way. But we have the three waves. Okay. Now, what I've found, I brought that. Well, there's even some more complicated, but I don't want to get into too much of that. But when I was on the air with George Nuri, he said, this explains the baby boomers. It's that age group, the baby boomers, because look at all the babies that were being born at that time. And also look at what happened in the 60s. The people, they didn't want war, they wanted peace. We had the hippies and the peace movement. They were all trying to make changes. They just didn't fit in with the violence that was going on in the world. But part of what I want to bring in here is the connection with the UFOs. You see, people are always thinking they're doing things to them. All they are doing is checking on their own. I told you, you agreed anyway, but if you're one of them, they know you're here, they're watching you to make sure you're going to be okay. That's part of the reasons for the implants, that they have to be able to locate you. They got to know where you are because you're one of them. A lot of the abductions, they don't like the word abductions. They like visitations better. A lot of that, you're taking you back to check on things and making sure everything is functioning, especially with the energy as you grow older, being more and more of that energy being downloaded into you. They have to go and make adjustments to make sure the energy is going to be accepted by the body in the correct way. So a lot of this, by all the machinery and things that people see on the UFOs, is as they are adapting the body and working with the body. And if the body is sick in any way, has any problems, they will do the things on the ship to adjust it and bring it back into harmony. And a lot of the implants, this is what they are, like time-release aspirins, time-release contact pills, to release things into the body to keep the body healthy. If you start understanding these things, you don't see it in a negative light. I said earlier, we see it by the ones who have the sessions and keep the person in the light levels, and they think, oh, something bad was done. But if you really get into the story of what's really happening, it is not negative at all. The sperms and the ova, they have programs. They're going to populate other planets. This is what they've been doing. They accumulate it, they keep it until they go to another place that needs to have life established, and they're going to do it there. This is where they do with the animals and everything. They said it doesn't matter what kind of a combination, we don't know what's going to work on that planet. He said, you could have been surprised at what you could have looked like. It all depends on the chemicals in the primeval soup of our planet, what will grow and what will develop. We developed along the mammal line. Other species develop along the reptilian line. Other people, other ones develop along the insectoid line. I've had some that mixed, they were all mixed together, and they were parts, and they were all living beings living on other planets. I've had people go back to lifetimes when they were the reptilians, and they were told, we're going to go, and they have a harder time with the energy adjusting. Some of the cases that I've written about, they have had things had to be put into the physical body to adapt the energy so it will adjust to the human body because it's such a different type of energy. And during the sessions, they were told, this being will never get sick because we don't want any doctors examining them and finding out what has been done to the body. They won't understand it at all. This is why the DNA is being changed. And I said, wouldn't the doctors notice the DNA being different? They said they would if they know what they're looking for. Well, a lot of them don't know what they're looking for, and so they don't see it. But the DNA is being changed because we are moving into this new earth that I've talked about before. In order to go into the new earth, our frequency and vibration has to be raised and changed and adapted. Otherwise, we can't go. We can't shift. And that's what's happening to all of you right now as we move into the new earth. He said, before, down through time, a civilization would reach the peak of development. I mean, they could do anything. Atlantis was only one of them. There were many others before that. You would get to the point where you could do absolutely anything with your mind. This is how they built the pyramids. They were able to raise the stones with their mind. They were able to make stones malleable to where they could form them in any way they wanted. They did away with disease. They could live as long as they wanted. The civilizations reached the peak of what you could do with your mind. And every time, there's always the man, I'm sorry to say. Women are the ones that don't seem to cause that much problems, I don't think. Women don't make the wars. They don't do all these other things. I'm sorry, guys. But in every case, it was the men who wanted power. They wanted greed. They wanted more. They're the ones that made the civilization had to be destroyed because they started doing the wrong things with their minds. I always think maybe they got bored. If you could do absolutely anything, you didn't age, you didn't get sick, you could do anything you wanted, maybe it would be boring and said, let's go ahead and try something else. So they began to get too much power. And this is what eventually led to the demise of the, especially Atlantis. They were using crystal powers. And they said, we haven't even begun to tap what we can do with crystals. The powers of crystals is tremendous. We're just beginning to scratch the surface. They could use crystals for anything. So they developed these systems, but then they also overdid it. Let me talk a little bit about Atlantis. They said one of the main reasons Atlantis had to go down was because they were going against the laws of nature. They were experimenting by combining animals and human. Your legends of the half man, half animals, they don't come from Greece. They came from Atlantis. They were handed down into the Greek legends, but they started with Atlantis. The, you know, the centaurs, the half man, half horse, the half man, half bull, all of these were experiments that the Atlanteans were doing. And a lot of it was done, they made servants out of them, slaves, and used them in different things like that. But they said they were disobeying the laws of nature. You're not supposed to fool around with things like that. It was one of the main reasons that Atlantis had to go down. They said, the one reason you have to know this is because your own civilization is doing the same thing. We're fast approaching that point where this cannot be allowed, the line has to be drawn. Some of you probably know about where they're introducing the human cells into the pigs so they can use the pig organs to transplant into the human body. Because the human body will reject something that is foreign, but it won't reject it if it has human cells. And that was the logic behind the whole thing. But there was one scientist who said, I don't think this is safe. Because, sure, you can eat pork, you can handle pigs, but what would happen if you put the organ in the human body and the blood was flowing through that constantly? He said, we could create a disease that there would be no cure for. And he said, you better take it slow here and really look at this. So they stopped the experimentation for a little while. But then they said, oh, I don't think it'll happen. So now they're doing it again. And they told me, you're going down the wrong way. You're headed down the same road of destruction that all the other ones have gone down. But in the case of Atlantis, a lot of it had to do with the crystals, too. They were using too much crystal power. They ended up making holes in the ozone layer that let the sun come through and was burning part. This is how some of the deserts were formed in the world. They were also creating too much power that the earth couldn't handle it. So they said this had to be stopped. It had gone too far. This is the explanation for the Bermuda Triangle. That was part of the original Atlantis. And if you can picture this, on that point, there was a temple, and they did time travel and time experimentation, going back and forth, and there was a temple that used crystals that they could open and close portals so they could travel through time. Well, when the Atlantis went down, that temple was destroyed, and the machines there were partially destroyed. So they're still firing in an erratic fashion. This is why if a ships or planes happen to be in the area and it would just shoot upward through the water, it causes them to be zapped into another portal into a different time. Now, does that make sense to you?
Yeah.
To me, I think it's the explanation of it. But they said every time through history, when the civilization would get to that point, we'd have to destroy it. And then we had to start all over again. They would leave a few survivors to begin again, erase all the knowledge that they had. Now, some of them were not erased that went to Egypt, and they're the ones that built the pyramids. But they had to start all over again from scratch. They said it was almost like they blew a fuse, and they couldn't allow the humans to continue that way. Let's just shut it down and start all over. But every time, look at the amount of time that had to be building up the civilization again and again and again. We are now approaching that point where we're at the same level. Psychic abilities are being brought back. Everything is happening. The mind is growing. We're learning more. We are reaching the point where we could be at the height that these other civilizations were. They don't want to have to destroy it and start all over again. But if we were foolish enough to get to that point, they would have to do it to shut us down and begin all over again. And they said there's no more time left. The earth is a living being. It is evolving. It is moving and changing. It is time for the earth itself to evolve and move into another dimension, into its next part. They said, the earth doesn't care if the human race goes with it or not. We're like fleas on a dog anyway. They don't like it because of the irritation we cause to this beautiful planet. It's going to evolve, whether we go or not. It'd be good if we could go with it because it's going into the next dimension, which is going to be extremely beautiful. It's going to be wonderful. But we can only go if our frequency and vibration matches the earth as it moves. So that's what's happening now. Now these beings, like I said, they are already here, and many of you are probably, some of them, you probably can identify with some of the things I said. You're all moving into this other dimension. Everyone will not go. Some won't be able to go. You can only go if your frequency matches the one you're going into. If you're caught up in the frequency of the earth, which is very dense and heavy, you're caught up into the negativity, you're not going to be able to move. You're not going to be able to go when the earth moves. Because you're going to, they said you must stay with what you have created. I think you all know people who are into the negativity. They're not into these things. Not that it makes us any better or worse, but their vibration is not the same. So they will not be able to change the vibration that quickly to move into the new earth. Now they said the person cannot change the frequency all at once. It's impossible. It would destroy the body. The energy is too great. It's too strong. So the energy must be gradually increased. And this began, I think, around 2003 is when it all started. It may have been going on before that. It became more noticeable about 2003. And people began noticing physical symptoms in their body. And a lot of them have told me, well, they go to the doctor and the doctor can't find anything wrong with them. And after a few days, the physical symptoms would go away and it would level out. Then maybe in a couple of months, it would start in again. the same different kinds of physical symptoms. And the doctor here wouldn't understand what was going on. So all of it has to do with the adjustment. And I had a client, the last one, we did the demo. I just came from giving a class in Hawaii, and our demo for the class demonstration was telling the same story. You know, she was one of these beings. She was the one that was a channel of energy. And she was, they were telling her her DNA had been changed, and that it was her husband was dying, and they said that was all right. He could not change the vibration and frequency. If you can't change the vibration, you'll just leave the planet. And they said, that's okay. Nothing wrong with that. You can't change it that quick. So as you adapt to it, you're able to move with it. You see what I'm talking about? But all of them aren't going to go. A lot of them are going to be caught up in the disasters, the tsunamis, the earthquakes. That's why so many are leaving all at one time. They want to get out of here and watch from the other side. They want to observe. They said, this is the greatest show on earth. ETs are loving it. Everybody's watching to see, are we going to be able to pull it off? Are we going to be able to do it? Because when I've asked them a lot of questions about the new earth, they said, we can't answer all your questions because we don't know. Nobody knows. This is the first time this has ever happened in the history of the universe that an entire planet will shift into another dimension, taking everything with it. You see why they had to do this, because they said we had to make some changes here. And that's why they brought in the pure souls, the new blood, those that don't have any karma. The ones that came in on these first waves had like a sheath, I guess you are, a coating put over them, their souls, so they will not accumulate karma, because they don't want to be stuck here. This is part of their problems on how we're going to handle all of this. It's very difficult for all of them. But I talked before about the New Earth and where we're going with that. Let me mention 2012. 2012 is not the end of the world. I don't care what that movie said or what other people are saying. The end of civilization as you know it, and you see why, because everything is going to be different. It's all going to be changed. But we've been told that 2012, it is like the culmination. There's no date that is, this is the end of it. It means it's going to level out at that point, and you're going to really notice some difference. And we were told too, the energy will be built to that point that it will push us into the next dimension. So it's like a culmination at that time. So I know there's probably going to be a lot of questions, and I've got about, I figured about a half hour, so I was going to allow questions, because I think we have probably a lot more things I can talk about with this. But it's going to be wonderful. It's going to be beautiful. You know, in the Bible, in Revelation, it talks about how the new heaven and the new earth, and how one is left and one is taken. That's what it was referring to. Only John on the Isle of Patmos, when he had the vision, didn't realize it was going to be thousands of years before it would actually happen. But he was talking about the new earth. If anybody has questions, let's go ahead and come up here, because line up here. But he didn't realize that this was the new earth that he was speaking about. But so there's a lot of things happening right now, and oh, maybe I better tell you the symptoms so you realize what's happening to your body before I forget. Because there are definite symptoms people are going through. One is high blood pressure. The other is heart palpitations. These will come and go. They may be for a few days, and this is what sends people to the doctor, but then it'll level off as the body adjusts to the energy. Heart palpitations, dizziness, headaches, aches and pains throughout the body, depression, Most of the time, they don't know where any of these symptoms are coming from. But these are the signs that your body is shifting and moving. The DNA is being changed and developed. And as it does, the body is reacting. So if you know that, you can write it out. Go with it. Does this kind of help explain the ET's part in all of this? From a different direction? All they're doing is watching over their own people. So they won't get lost in this gigantic soup we've got here. They're making sure that they're going to be okay and leading them through. One man at one conference said, "How can I get in that program?" I said, "I don't know. I'm not in charge of that." Okay. Let my daughter come up here, because sometimes I have problems hearing the questions with the microphone. And okay. With my daughter Julia, she's some of these we've had her sitting on the stage too, because she's always got good comments, and she's understanding it a lot too, but we don't understand it all because it's never happened before. But okay, they got the light run on you. Okay, go ahead and see.
I was wondering what your take on Planet X is.
Planet X. What your take on Planet X?
There is no such thing. Okay.
Thank you.
You know how many years of Planet X they've been talking about that? I guess it's been 10, 15 years, they keep saying, the Planet X is going to hit the Earth. In my book on Nostradamus and my book on Jesus and the Essenes, they talk about another planet that's out there, and it has an elliptical orbit, and it does come around from time to time. This is the one that Zechariah Sitchin calls Nibiru. But it's not going to do anything. If it had, they would have told me. Unless it maybe kind of coincide with the shift that we're moving into the new Earth, but don't worry about it. Oh, that's another thing I forgot to say. The main thing they wanted us to do, if you want to go, you've got to get rid of karma. You've got to get rid of the karma, or you're stuck on the wheel of Earth, because you have to return again and again to repay it. You're not going to be able to move unless you get rid of the karma. You know what that means. Forgive. Forgive, forget, and let it go. It's not important. It's not important at all. You want to move on. You don't want to have to come back and do it again with the same people, same situation. And you'll be trapped to do that if you don't get rid of it now. The second thing they said you've got to get rid of if you want to move on is fear. Get rid of the fear. Don't buy into fear. And you know, the government and the churches are very big on fear. Think for yourself. Don't buy into what's on TV. Don't buy into what's in the newspapers. Think for yourself. Swine flu. You know, think for yourself and ask lots and lots of questions. Then make up your own mind what you want to believe. Don't give your power away to anyone. Think for yourself. So they said, get rid of karma and get rid of fear, and then you're free to move into this beautiful thing we're going into. Okay.
I see the light.
Oh, yeah, it's shining right on you.
Earlier you...
I see the light.
Right there, like...
Okay.
Earlier, you spoke about something new you are doing as far as teaching a new way of healing, and I would like for you to go into more details about what is that healing, because many of us in here are healers of some kind. I'm a hands-on healer.
It's not hands-on, no.
But I'd like to know more about what that is, and also how we can study that with you, and how we can find out where you will be and how we can study it.
Okay. All right, that's what I'm teaching all over the world, because it's taken me 30 years to develop it, and it's done with my hypnosis technique. Oh. It's not like any form of hypnosis out there, and we're able to work with the person, and this force that I was talking about comes through the person and heals any disease, any ailment instantly. I only see the person one time, and it happens immediately in my office or wherever I am. It's instant healing, because you make yourself sick. If your mind is powerful enough to make yourself sick, it's also powerful enough to heal you when you find out what's causing it. So that's what I do, is I teach how to do this step by step. And it's a 3-day class that I give.
And even if we've never studied hypnosis, we would be able
Doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter.
In the beginning, I was only teaching those who were hypnotists, and then I found that other people were begging. I have a passion, I want to help people. So we let anybody in, and we're finding out they are learning it faster because they don't have the other ones to say, this is the only way to do it. So we're teaching it all over the world now. I had 91 students in one class in Perth, and we're teaching doctors in Russia and all over the world. I'm giving the classes, and we have them all over the United States too. And if you check our website, it tells our schedule. And anybody can learn it. Of course, you have to want to do it. You have to have the desire to help people. Mm-hmm. But it's very effective. Some of them say they've never gone back to any other way of healing once they've
done
this.
Thank you very much.
Check my website. It's Ozark Mountain, OZARKMT.com, which gives the schedule of our classes. Okay.
Thank you for a very good lecture here. I wanted to ask you, when you wanted to change your DNA or going up to the higher, will crystals be helpful to that?
With
crystal power?
What?
When you want to change your DNA, will crystals be helpful for that?
Well, you're not the one that's changing it. You're not the one that's changing your DNA. They are.
Uh-huh.
I don't know if crystals would have anything to do with it at all. They did say that crystals, we don't know the power of crystals, but though they are working with the body, and a lot of it happens when you're sleeping at night, you don't even know it, because then that conscious mind is out of the way. This is when I talked about these physical symptoms. This is what's happening as the DNA is being changed. But you can't make it happen yourself.
Can you pray for it or something, any help?
Well, you just ask. It's all love.
All love.
Like I said, get rid of karma.
Yes.
And you know, I think most of you, as long as you're aware something is happening, you're on the beginning. You're making the steps. It's the other ones that don't care or don't know anything is happening. You can ask them. You might ask them, is my DNA being changed? And listen and see what answers you get. You can do a lot through meditation, and you can talk to them that way.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Not be blinded. You remember that line?
See, that mic distorts, and that's why I heard to tell me.
I have actually a two-part question, and it deals with the shift that's coming up. The first part of it is part of the symptoms that we're receiving, would you say, would be like a low buzz, or in some cases a high pitch
yes.
buzz in one of our ears?
Yeah, I have clients.
I've been experiencing a lot of that.
I have a lot of clients, that's one of their main complaints, is ringing in the ears and
yeah.
sounds in the ears. They said that is frequency adjustment.
Right.
They are adjusting the frequency, and that's what makes the sounds in the ear.
Okay.
And they said the adjustment is so that you can, you'll adapt and receive information. Oh, also, anybody who has had sightings of UFOs doesn't mean you've been taken on board. They said whenever you see a UFO, all they are doing, they said, we have to stop your world for a fraction of a second. We have to catch you off guard. And I said, well, we aren't on guard. And they said, oh, yes, you are. We have to stop your world for a fraction of a second so we can download the information. And I said, what do you mean? You get their attention. They said, we are downloading information at the cellular level of the brain. And it's being put in everyone's head, especially if they are seeing UFOs. And I said, what's the information for? So that you can use it when we go through all of this. the shifting and everything is going through, you will have the information and you won't even know where it came from. It'll be there to help us move through this time. So it's all for a reason.
Okay, yeah, thanks for adding that. The second part was about several years ago when I first heard someone talk about the shift coming up. They mentioned that there would be what's being called a 3 days of darkness period that would happen. Have you received 3 days of darkness?
3 days of darkness.
Have you heard about any of that?
Well, they said they've already done stuff like that. There were times in the past, I think it was in the 70s or something, they had to make an adjustment to the sun. And so they just shut everybody down in the whole world.
So
you didn't know anything about it. While they made adjustments to the sun, you woke up the next morning, continued on your life, not even realizing you had lost so many days.
Oh, so we won't be experiencing that in 2012.
So a lot of it, you won't even be aware of it if it happens.
Okay. Well, from when I first heard about it, it sounded like it was something. I guess we like go through like an almost unconscious period for those 3 days while we're...
Well, you were. See, you were unconscious because you weren't aware that something was being done to the world. They said this has happened a lot of times. It's easier just to pull a switch and shut everybody off and then turn them back on when we're finished.
Okay, well, that answers that then. Okay. Thank you.
So you might not have to worry about it if you're not aware of it.
Okay. Hi, Dolores. You mentioned earlier on that ETs put us on this earth to evolve at our own free will. But a first speaker yesterday stated that ETs put us on the earth as a slave race. So I'm now somewhat confused. So why is our first speaker wrong and you're right?
I didn't get any of that. Go ahead.
Okay.
See, accents have on me too, yeah.
That the ETs put us on the earth to evolve.
Yeah. No. No, you know where that came from? You know where that idea came from?
Whose idea?
Zachariah Sitchin.
Which one? Yours or
about
the first
the slave race.
Yeah, but okay,
that's
where it came from.
That happened after the life was formed, after the human being was formed and was evolving, another race came in. And this is the one that's mentioned in the Bible, in the Old Testament. They're the ones who were mining gold and wanted the race to be slaves. But they didn't create the race. They took advantage of it and turned them into slaves. The race was already developed long before that.
So he's wrong.
Came in and found out.
They're both right.
Yeah.
Well, they're both wrong.
There was not the beginning.
There was a slave race, but that was not why they were put here. I mean, they're both right in that they were here to evolve and there is a slave race, but he was not correct in saying that they were put here for that purpose. They were already here.
No, the other ones
came in
and
used them. What you're saying is that the first speaker was wrong then. I just want to
clarify. And when the original ones found out what was going on, they made the other group of ETs leave because they were going against the rules of the council. They had to leave at that time, and then they left the race alone so it could evolve again. They were watching everything. But they said there are definite rules and regulations. They cannot interfere with the Earth. But sometimes some will sneak in, and they find that out, and they make them leave, and they're really reprimanded for what they have done. So you got to think and look at it two separate things.
Okay. Well, thanks very much.
Okay. So, I mean, look at things from a different direction. Okay.
According to your information, abductees that have had implants are first-time Earth incarnators, is that correct? Or most of them, majority of them, or?
The implants?
Yeah, the abductees.
The abductees with implants, they are
first-time.
Well, there are ways of keeping track of the person because they want to know where you are and they have to watch you. If anything is going to happen, they want to be there to help you, make sure you're going to be safe. So they are locator devices. But there could be some that just agreed to be in the program, too. I said, before you come into the earth, the life, and they'll say, do you want to be a part of this?
Nothing definitive like that. No.
Okay. I'm going to tell you an interesting case I just had. This man thought he had had an abduction experience and everything, they come like that and they want to know advice about it. And I always tell them, don't open that can of worms unless you're really ready to accept what you're going to find. You may not find what you like. He was a little boy, and he was sure that something had happened. Him and his friend were out riding bicycles. And I think he lost time in there, and he always was sure something had happened. Well, we went through the story. He was taken, but he was not supposed to be taken. He was in the wrong place at the wrong time. He was supposed to be his friend. And they did with him, they put him in a container so that he wouldn't contaminate them and they wouldn't contaminate him, because it's like they were afraid of what he had. So he was isolated, so he wouldn't have anything to do with him. And it was his friend was the one who was supposed to have been taken. And it's like wrong place, wrong time. The demon came, not finished, they put him back where he was supposed to be. He said, oh, I guess I wasn't good enough, huh? So sometimes it's things like that. But see, it shows they're afraid of getting something off of us. So he was separated and isolated.
Is time travel experimentation something that will get us Earth humans exterminated? Something that we're not supposed to be meddling in? Or is it just benign?
Time travel?
Yeah, is it benign or is it something that's going to get us terminated?
Time travel experimentation, is it something that will get us annihilated or get us in, or is it?
It's been going on for a long, long time. You mean the government?
I mean on Earth, yeah.
Oh, our government. Yeah. Our government's been doing it for a long time. It's not advisable because they don't know what they're doing.
Right.
And I've had cases where people have been moved out of the way if they were getting too close to something like that, and they were picked up and put back in their motel room, and they said, well, they were in the wrong place. They could have been hurt because the government doesn't know the energy they're working with. But they've been working with it for a long time. It won't lead us to annihilation. It's just going to lead us to
stuff they can't handle. Yeah, like the atomic bomb was.
No, not that one.
Was there any information that who leaked the did the atomic bomb come the information come naturally, or was it imparted by some alien race, possibly the one?
Well, do you know who was the main person involved in the invention of the atomic
Oppenheimer
bomb?
Einstein, yeah.
And they've said many times he got his information from ETs.
Or are these the ones who were living under the pyramids?
He didn't know it. He just got it, like we said, the information was coming in. But he even said himself he didn't want it to be turned into a weapon. He was very upset when they did that.
In your research, did they ever say if this information came from? For example, the ones that were living underneath the pyramid that Billy Meyer is always talking about, they were removed from the planet. They were trying to control the planet. Have you got any information on those guys?
They didn't say who gave it to him.
Yeah.
But they just said we weren't ready for it yet, and it shouldn't have been given here at
it
that
wasn't,
time.
You're saying it wasn't natural.
It wasn't time for it yet.
Yeah, okay.
When it was supposed to come, we were supposed to be using it for good, for healing, and for energy, and not for the weapon.
Well, great discoveries like that. Does the information ever come up totally naturally, not from an outside source, or is it all from an outside source?
Yeah, that's what I said. They spread the information and they'll say this is now time.
Uh-huh.
With the invention of the computers, the invention of the heart surgeries, all of this, they put the information out there and it's time. Whoever gets it can use it, but if they don't use it in the right way, they can't come back and say you're not doing it right.
Okay, thank you.
Uh-huh. Look at things a little differently. I think our minds are still active. We can invent, but they're helping it with it.
Who really caused the destruction of Atlantis? Was it the ETs or the Atlanteans?
Who was the
really
first?
Who caused the destruction of Atlantis, the ETs or
the Atlanteans? But the ETs had a part in it because, let me see. I've had several people, you might not like this, but I've had a couple, at least two or three, who are back now. And they didn't know this on a conscious level. When they went under, they said, we are here as one they call the final solution. They said, if Earth doesn't get it right, we're here to annihilate you all again. And I was thinking, oh boy. And they said, we were there at Atlantis. They said, that's our job. So it's not ETs, it's another being altogether. And it was, they were there, and they said, we were there at Atlantis. And I said, well, we're watching you all. And they said, it looks good. It looks like you're on the right path, that you're going in the right direction. But if you don't, then it would mean they'd have to do their job again. And I said, well, I hope it won't come, they'll listen to you. And he said, they didn't before. And the way he said it was so cold. This is in Convoluted 3 that I got that. And I was going to end the book on that note. And she said, no, that's a negative note. So when the person woke up, they just said, wow, you know, and they keep emailing me. Have you heard anybody else who said they were that kind of a power that was here? So we don't know on a conscious level.
Okay, but
I ended the book differently because I didn't want to end on a negative.
Okay, but I thought that the higher intelligences, including ETs, cannot interfere with us.
We thought the higher intelligence, including ETs, could not interfere with us.
That's what I said. Unless we get to the point we're going to destroy the Earth. Then they have to.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
This is, it's so much, it's hard to say black and white, you know, that this is this and this. It's just too much information. Okay.
I saw you back in Sedona, and you had mentioned how a meteorite brought many pathogens to the Earth and really set the humanity back. And now I've been working on this problem, and now we're dealing with a medical profession that's absolutely betrayed us and only wants to make money and doesn't want to cure anything. Well, I've come up with an invention that you use in the water, bathtub, hot spring, hot tub, lake, or swimming pool. With a silver anode and cathode, you get in with a mic in between and with a microcurrent, and it absolutely pulls everything out of you. It's worked on arthritis, neuropathy, fibromyalgia, restless leg, and MRSA. I had MRSA myself and cured that with it. And that's the deadly flesh-eating Streptococcus aureus. Bacteria. It's
and
I've got one of these machines here to show if anybody's interested in it. And I think
I've heard of lots of different machines that are being used.
Yeah, there's more coming on, and this one is, really works. I mean, it's fabulous. I haven't found anything like it that comes close.
There's
to
a lot of things happening. You know,
there
a lot
is.
Of people are inventing things. A lot of people are making new discoveries. Because this is all part of everything changing.
Right.
Because we go into the new Earth, it's just going to be wonderful.
My question is why was this meteorite allowed to hit the Earth? Why didn't the ETs catch it, intercept it, and stop it?
What is what?
The meteorite
why
that...
Why was the meteorite allowed to hit the Earth? Why didn't the ETs catch it or do something that...
People have asked me that before. This has to do with the Keepers of the Garden, because it was supposed to be a planet with a being that would never get sick and never die. We'd just be like them. It was like the Garden of Eden. It was supposed to be absolutely perfect. But when we were developing is when the meteorite came and hit the Earth. And when it did, it brought disease for the first time and contaminated the developing species. And they went back to the council and they were very unhappy. They said, what do we do? Our experiment is spoiled. It will never be what we intended it to be because disease had been introduced. They said, do we wipe it all out and start over again, or do we just let it continue the way it is, knowing it will never be perfect? And they decided to let it go along, which is another reason why of the abductions, they're checking the body, they are upgrading the body. They want to see how the cancer is developing in the body, how the pollutants in the air and our food is contaminating the body because we are on the way to being what they want us to be. But like he said, how did they know? Well, you know, they're off doing all kinds of other things too. They weren't watching us all the time.
Yeah, so it
just maybe
slipped
the
by.
Meteorite came in.
Yeah.
They didn't know it. But it did spoil the experiment anyway.
I bet. Anybody wants to see this device, I have it.
Okay.
I mean, it works like nothing.
Are you in the vendor room?
No, I'm not in the vendor.
Oh, okay.
But I've got it here. I'm going to let a couple of people use it tonight and try it out.
Okay, then. Thank you. Let's see, we've still got a few more minutes, I think, here. I don't know if anybody's following me or not.
Well, Dolores, I'd like to say thank you for taking the time to make the presentation here this evening, or this afternoon, with your busy schedule.
There's so much information in Hawaii. I started at 6:30. We didn't get through to midnight. They wouldn't let me quit talking.
Thank you.
So I don't want to do that again.
I'm real curious of the information you've shared this afternoon. I'm a partner and friends with a channel and author by the name of Jill Mara. And she's written Keys to Soul Evolution, and she says exactly the same in the information she's channeled that you discussed tonight. Now, in that book, they discuss what to expect prior to, during, and after the shift. And what I'm curious about is, have any of your clients gone into the future, since at that point we're losing time and space, and described those events and how we'll be seeing things? And I'm just curious about comparing notes with what they've said.
They have, and see, I do a workshop where I take people into the future. But it's probabilities, possibilities.
Right.
Nothing is set in stone. Everything depends on the decision you make. Because in your own life, you make a decision, your life could be totally different. And mankind as a race makes a decision, it could be totally different. In my books on Nostradamus, he said there are many different paths you could go down.
That's what they say.
We do see it as beautiful anyway.
Okay.
Of course, you have the opposite, but that's the old earth, that they're going to stay with that. But there are too many probabilities and possibilities to say this has to happen.
Will you be available to meet outside later?
Did you do one?
To discuss some things.
It's going to be.
What a crowd.
There's a lot of people want to meet outside.
Okay. We'll see if there's time to meet you outside. Oh, great. Fantastic. Okay. Thank you.
That's even Nostradamus said, the future is up to you, each and every one of you. You create your reality. Everything that's in your life, you create and you put there. If you realize your mind is that strong, you can uncreate anything in your life that you don't like. The power of your mind is tremendous.
Thank you.
Okay. I think these two, and that's going to have to be it.
Yes, I appreciate you taking our questions. It seems that our DNA lately has really been attacked, whether it be from the chemtrails or from going to the scanning machines at the airport.
I don't think any of that's doing anything.
You don't? Okay, well, that's what I was questioning.
Oh, forget. You have control over your body.
Do we? When they're spraying chemtrails?
Well, I don't believe in the chemtrails anyway.
Okay.
If it doesn't exist in my reality, it shouldn't exist in your reality. Yeah, don't worry about it. See, that's fear. I told you have to get rid of fear. If you're afraid of something, you draw it to you. You give it energy. Anything you fear, you create it because you're giving it power and energy. Don't worry about it. It won't exist in your reality. Okay.
Well, thank you for being here. And I have been in touch with my ET guide since I was a small child. And about 16 months ago, they informed me that I had to become a vegetarian to raise my frequency. And I just want
to
tell everybody.
Yeah. That I didn't know how much time we have, but people are always coming. They always ask when they come to me. Yeah, it says time's up. I finish immediately. Okay. They're always saying, what about their diet? They want to know if they're eating the right foods. They always say the same thing. The best foods for the body is live foods. And by live foods, they mean fresh fruits and vegetables. They say stay away from the heavy meats, beef and pork. In order to move when the earth shifts, you got to make the body lighter. And the heavy foods hold you to the earth. So you don't eat the heavy meats like beef and pork. They said you can eat some chicken and fish, but vegetables are the best thing. They don't say become a vegetarian, but that's the best food. Stay away from a lot of sugar and drink lots and lots of water. The value of water is beyond belief. But you learn to trust your body. If you can get organic foods, the better, but do the best you can. But stay away from the heavy meats.
Well, I was instructed that I definitely had to become a vegetarian. And I just want to make a note to everybody, it has totally simplified my life. And I've become more prosperous because of it. I have left less decisions to make. Mm-hmm. And it's just cleared my mind totally and my body.
Yes, I work with swamis at the ashrams and the yogas. I work with people all over the world. And that's their lifestyle, but I still like a little chicken and fish once in a while anyway. But
well, I've really got to go.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dolores Cannon.
Thank you. Okay. We came out just about 5 minutes over. It's not too
perfect.
Bad.
Yeah, Dolores and I are going out for ribs now, so...